I used to think this was the beginning of your story. Memory is a strange thing. It doesn't work like I thought it did. We are so bound by time, by its order. But now I'm not so sure I believe in beginnings and endings.
The original inspiration for Story of Your Life had to do with actually the physics, Fermat's principle of least time and variational principles of physics. Those were something that I had read about a long time ago, and I'd always found those fascinating. And eventually it occurred to me that I could use those as a way of telling a story about a character facing the inevitable, a character who knew the future but could not change it, and how the character reacts to that.
Our experience tends to be moment by moment. It's like this happens, then the next thing happens, then the next thing happens. And that's actually the way our language is set up as well. Our language is very one-dimensional. It's you say one word, then the next word, then the next word. It doesn't have to be that way. Even when we look at things visually, we're often confronted with, you know, a whole image all at once. It's not just something where we go one step, then the next, then the next. In fact, often in the way that these things are analyzed in physics and in mathematics, we're looking instead at what's the whole picture of what happens, not sort of step by step, but just what's the whole thing that happens, what's the complete structure that gets built, rather than how do we set down every brick in the structure as we build it.
Variational principles are a class of equations for describing physical phenomena which differ from the ones that most people are familiar with. Usually when people think about, say, mechanics of like one object bouncing off another, we think of it in terms of cause and effect. Something happens, and then as a result, something happens after that, and then something else happens after that. So that is a causal explanation for physical phenomena. But with variational principles, you can describe physical phenomena by picking two endpoints, the state of a system at the beginning of a period of time and the state of the system at the end of that period of time. Then from that, you can deduce the behavior of that system during that period.
So a way to think about this, if you're trying to understand a person walking across a room, you can say, well, okay, the person walks across the room by putting one foot in front of the next, and there's a whole sort of mechanism, a sequence of things that happen. Or you can say, what's happening is the person walks across the room, the complete story of what occurred. These are two sort of different ways to describe the same kind of phenomena.
But you need to define both the starting point and the ending point before you can determine how the system is going to behave. So with this type of mathematical equation, you're not exactly working backwards, but you do need to know the end point before you can solve the equations. And this is a very different way of understanding how physical systems work. This is more of a teleological way of looking at things than a causal one, meaning, in a sense, it is a goal-oriented way of understanding the behavior of systems. And it turns out that variational principles, they generate the exact same description as any other, you know, causal description of physical systems. So they're, in a sense, mathematically equivalent. But from a sort of philosophical standpoint, they're very different. And the causal interpretation is one that we understand pretty intuitively, but the teleological one strikes most people as kind of odd. And it has been the subject of a lot of sort of philosophical writing on the part of various physicists through history.
When we think about how alien brains, alien intelligences might work, it's certainly something that's on the table to imagine that the way that alien intelligences experience the universe is not by our kind of step-by-step method, but by a method that's also perfectly visible in the kind of science that we do, which is this more whole sequence in time, variational principle kind of approach.
How can you know the future?
There's this famous quote of Einstein that the distinction between past, present, and future is nothing but a stubbornly persistent illusion. Relativity does say that the future and past, they have equal validity to the present, that all events are kind of frozen in this giant block. We just happen to perceive, you know, one end of the block as the past and the other end of the block as the future, and that we are sort of moving in a certain direction. But that is just a function of our perception that doesn't reflect any physical reality. The laws of physics are all what they call time symmetric. You could reverse the arrow of time in all physical equations and it remains the same. So at a fundamental physical level, there isn't a difference between the past and the future. So, you know, then there's the question of like, well, we obviously perceive there to be a difference between the past and the future, and why is that? Why is it that we can remember the past, but we have no knowledge of the future? This is a question which scientists have been working on for a while. There is this theory that has to do with the relationship between memory and entropy, which is sort of the amount of disorder there is in the universe. The universe began with the Big Bang, which is an extremely low entropy state, and we believe the universe will end in, say, the heat death of the universe, which is an extremely high entropy state. And so entropy is steadily increasing between the Big Bang and the heat death. And it's believed that the formation of memories may inevitably entail an increase in entropy. And if that is the case, that means that recording any event means that the event being recorded has to be closer to the Big Bang than it is to the heat death, which means that's why we remember the past, because we are remembering the lower entropy direction, and that is the direction toward the Big Bang, and that is why we call that the past.
It's worth realizing that in terms of when we talk about memory, we always think it's much easier to know the past than to know the future. Usually that's true. But, you know, imagine, I don't know, a raindrop falling, for example. It's really easy to know the future of the raindrop. It's going to fall and go splat. It's quite hard to know the past. You know, how did it form in that cloud and all those kinds of things. So sometimes our science lets us easily know the future, not so easily know the past. It just happens that our typical sort of human experience is that we remember the past. It's a little bit of a different experience to try and predict the future. It's not necessarily the case that that's how things have to work. And certainly in the physics that we know, in the mathematics that we know around that physics, it's quite often just as easy to predict the future as it is to know the past. So it's something that's a conceivable possibility that a brain, a way of thinking about things, could be set up where it's really as familiar with the things that it can predict in the future as it is the things that it knows from the past.
I know what it is.
What?
It's not a weapon. It's a gift.
The weapon is their language. They gave it all to us. Do you understand what that means?
So we can learn heptapod, if we survive.
If you learn it, when you really learn it, you begin to perceive time the way that they do. So you can see what's to come.
Originally, all I knew is that I wanted a story about a character who knew what was going to happen in the future. And then I had to figure out, how do I want my character to gain this knowledge of the future? And I considered a couple possibilities, that the character might take some drug, or the character might engage in some form of meditation. But neither of those seemed particularly interesting. And then it occurred to me that I could have my character learn a language, and learning that language would grant the ability to know the future. And that seemed like a very interesting scenario. So then I knew my character had to be a linguist.
First, we need to make sure that they understand what a question is, okay? The nature of a request for information along with the response.
Not everybody knows what linguists do. So as linguists, we're interested in language as a cognitive system, right? So language is the thing that really sets us apart from other species. All humans speak a language, and what's really remarkable that we have learned as linguists is that even though languages sound very different from each other, and we know if we've tried to learn another language as an adult that they can behave very differently in many ways, but it's also remarkable how many properties languages have in common. And so as linguists, we're interested in understanding what are the shared characteristics of all human languages? What is it that allows human babies to learn languages so easily and effortlessly? And what are the ways in which they can be different? Because we see that they can be very different, but they also differ in very limited ways. So there seem to be sort of recipes for languages that we find. We find common patterns popping up in unrelated languages. And so trying to understand what is it that languages share in common, and what are the ways in which they can be different.
If you immerse yourself into a foreign language, that you can actually rewire your brain?
It is a Cyberwarf hypothesis. It's the theory that the language you speak determines how you think, and...
Yeah, it affects how you see everything.
There's this idea in linguistics called the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis, which is the idea that the language you speak shapes your thought processes. It may even determine or set limits on what ideas it is possible for you to have, what kind of thoughts you can think.
It's controversial in linguistics how much this might actually be possible. I mean, as I mentioned earlier, we know that all human languages share a lot of basic properties in common, and we also know that kids can learn any language, right? So a little kid who grows up speaking one language can equally easily learn any other language of the world. And so based on these deep commonalities that languages have, I think it's an interesting question to think about how much might learning or speaking another language actually influence how you think about the world. When it comes to learning an alien language, I think all bets are off.
One of the people it's named after, Benjamin Whorf, he did a lot of work on the Hopi language, and he thought that the way time was treated in the Hopi language would have made it very easy for the Hopi to understand Einstein's relativity. He thought that relativity was a trivial concept expressed in Hopi. Most of Whorf's work on Hopi has since been discredited, but you know, that idea remains, I think, a really interesting one. So I thought that an alien language might be a good way for my character to gain knowledge of the future. The idea that the future is no different than the present or the past, that doesn't sit well with a lot of people, because we like to think of the future as being indeterminate, open-ended, and not fixed the way the past is. But as I said, physics suggests that the future is just as fixed as the past. Philosophically, there have been arguments in favor of determinism for as long as there have been philosophers, because if every act is a result of previous causes, then the future should follow inevitably from the past, and then there is no ambiguity or uncertainty about what will happen. It should follow inevitably from what has happened. So if it were possible to know the future, that would not enable you to change the future, which means knowing the future would not be as useful as a lot of people think it would be, because you couldn't act on it. You couldn't change anything. You couldn't prevent any undesired outcomes, because essentially the future has already happened. So you can't change the future any more than you can change the past. And so from a standpoint of, you know, human psychology, this raises this question of, you know, could someone cope with this psychologically? Could someone deal with knowing the future even though they were unable to change it or avoid it? And I think that's a really interesting question. Louise knows what will happen in her future very specifically, but in a general sense, Louise's situation is kind of similar to the situation that we are all in, because we all know certain things about our future. We all know that we are going to die. There is nothing we can do to change that. We all have this awareness of our mortality. So one of the fundamental problems of human existence is coping with that knowledge, whether you can find a way to move forward and live life as best you can, even though you know that you're going to die.
You want to make a baby.
If you can avoid sort of falling into despair despite these things that you are unable to change.
Despite knowing the journey and where it leads, I embrace it.
Well, guess what, Star Stuff?
every moment of it.